with Pink Floyd's Adam Hartmother, and the guitar success seemed unlimited.
I've moved around with guitars and tried many different things, and I've always come back to the Stratocaster because there was already a lot of me in it, and that's what Fender gave me, was access to me, if you like, for a place, an instrument that really I could put my personality into, and it would stay there. Because the thing about these instruments is that they're almost like blank canvases. They're very simple.
The Stratocaster had enjoyed a checkered career. It had traveled from blues to rhythm and blues, and in the late 70s, it was to influence Nile Rodgers, the man behind the disco sound. Rodgers and his Fender Strat, bought from a New York pawn shop, was responsible for more than 100 million record sales worldwide.
This one guitar right here has been on more hit records than I can imagine. I've probably played on at least 30 big records with this guitar. And a couple of years ago, I put it away. I made some sort of irrational rock and roll decision one morning. I got up and said, I want to switch to a Telecaster today. And I switched. And I didn't get a gold record for about 3 years. High Love, and believe it or not, I was just about to walk out of the house with my telly, and I said, and I went and got this baby. And I think High Love was a pretty big record, so there must be some sort of magic or karma in this thing.
Tina had heard, for these demos, I'd done it. She wanted me to play guitar, so I wagged my old beat up guitar. She was laughing so hard, man. She looked at that old equipment, she was going, oh man, she just got so tickled. But when I plugged it up and hit into a couple of licks, she quit laughing and started dancing.
The guitar was now a worldwide success. The Stratocaster had become associated with slick music production and with huge stadium rock concerts, a far cry from its country origins. Many musicians feared it was getting too big for its own good. The guitar was in danger of becoming a piece of expensive memorabilia. Vintage guitars, once played by the Beatles and Jimi Hendrix, were sought after by collectors who saw them as gilt-edged investment opportunities.
Now, Jimi Hendrix's Fender, showing on my left, 135,000, 140,000, £145,000. £170,000 on the nearer telephone. Would anybody like to bid? £180,000.
I mean, I know guys that buy them to hang them on a wall and look at them because they're so beautiful, you know? I mean, I feel that's a kind of a sin, but I can always take them off the wall and play them, right?
Yngwie Malmsteen, for example, I went to his house. He had like 50 million Stratocasters adorning the walls. He had a gold one that was like one of three ever made. You know, he said it cost $30,000. He had it hanging on the wall by a little nail and the tuning peg just like holding it there. And going, yeah, that's a great way to treat a $30,000 guitar.
This is a tree, you know? I mean, honor it, play it. Let the music live. Don't put it in a storehouse someplace in Tokyo and say, look what I got. Show it at parties. You know, that's not what this is about.
There was a fear that the Strat had gone beyond the reach of the working musicians that Leo Fender had in mind when he first set up his guitar factory all those years before.
Collected assets of CBS, which has probably been the best investment anybody in the music business has ever made to date.
In 1985, Bill Schultz headed a management buyout and successfully bought back the Fender Company from CBS. He was determined to take the Stratocaster back to its roots, making it once more a hand-finished quality instrument.
It was committed to the guitar and the player and the people that were using the instrument. He listened to them every day and said, okay, then I got to change this, and he'd change it. In the CBS corporate era, we lost a lot of that. There was a lot less attention to the player and to the customer and what they wanted, and got more of a, well, this is what we do, like it or leave it. And a lot of us that were there at the time, you know, as players, as builders, as workers in the factory, didn't feel that way, but that was the direction we were pointed. When Bill Schultz and his group bought the company from CBS, it got right back to Leo's premise, which is listen to the musician. And what Bill did that was better than what, in my estimation, what Leo did, was the fact that he put the businessmen where they belonged and put the musicians where they belonged and put the guitar builders where they belonged. And so you had this perfect niche for all the types of people that were necessary to make business successful. And that really was the secret of the rejuvenation process.
And now the Fender Stratocaster is an excellent instrument, built as Leo Fender designed it.
We have people in this custom shop where I'm sitting who just can't wait to come to work because they build their dreams here.
And when I was at school, In English literature and history classes, I was drawing guitars. I was drawing Stratocasters instead of doing any work. That was how much I loved the guitar. I just loved to look at them, and they were magic.
The best one always in the shop was a Fender Stratocaster that was like a big spaceship thing compared to all the others. And I always wanted to get that one down and play on it, but you know, the guy would always go, hey, get your hands off, play one of these, you know, these little cheap, nasty ones. And that was like a big thing in wanting one, because it was so sort of taboo to pick it off the wall.
I can still remember there was one at the bottom of our road that when it eventually turned up, it was a Strat about this color. Looking at it for weeks, every day on the way to and from school, and I'd never been as close to one before. It was on the other side of the glass, you know, but it was about 3 feet away. So that was a very exciting time for me, because before that, I'd just had a catalogue, and I know what a Fender catalogue actually smells like. It's got a very definite scent to it, you know. And if I could have eaten it, I think I would have done.
Stratocaster gave us Buddy Holly, Jimi Hendrix, Eric Clapton, and Stevie Ray Vaughan. And in the 90s...